Paul Ray Rosenbaum was your regular boy next door who attended school at PS 179 in Fresh Meadows, New York. He hung out with his older brother Mark and his cousins, David and Rachel. He wrote his first letters to his family from school and from camp in 1963. Just like some other kids, he dealt with math tests as best he could. Although, when it came to counting his dimes and pennies, he seemed to do pretty well. He discovered a love for films at an early age, did quite all right with his spelling exam, loved baseball, and as a hobby, kept a stamp collection. Paul moved to professional children's school in Manhattan when he was in seventh grade, where he attended school with celebrities like Yo-Yo Ma, Adam Arkin, and Irene Cara. Being who he is, he managed to get himself into trouble every once in a while. Like in this essay where he was supposed to define the meaning of poetry, he writes, "Poetry is sitting in room 502 at the professional children's school, having Miss David yelling, 'Shut up, kids!'" Well, Miss David was not amused. His report cards vary. Some saw his athletic ability and called him a fine gentleman, while one teacher said he should pay more attention. He impressed an art teacher with a wooden sailboat he constructed and chose one of his drawings to be selected for the school's mural. He was an innocent, sweet boy who made a baker's cookbook for pudding, candy, and cookies. However, here he is later moving on to the not-so-innocent kind of baking. Check out this recipe for herb brownie that indicates that it requires 1/3 to half cup of herb. Nonetheless, he was a loving son who wrote his parents from camp asking for glue and models, wishing them a good summer. There were the good days at camp, and then there were the not-so-good days. He wrote of being thankful for being able to give to the needy and for having a good home with parents that love him. He made out a gift certificate to his mother during Mother's Day when he promised to help her out every day, including dust the furniture. He drew artwork with his "I Love You" notes for her and even asked her to RSVP for a class invitation. And of course, he also wrote his beloved dad, to Pop, "You're not a polar bear, even though you look like one, but you are a great Pop. Love, Paul." We've got more to tell you about Paul's folks, but first, a word from our sponsors.
Mom! Hey, Mom! The Ajax cleanser! It shakes out white, turns blue!
That's right.
Why?
This is Ajax cleanser. It has a whole new chemistry. See that? Blueberry stains. Ajax shakes out white, turns blue.
Why?
As it changes color, it powers out stains.
Cleanser. As it changes color, it powers out stains.
Look, Ray! It's snowing!
Let's not touch a big ape. Hold it!
Before you guys go anywhere, you're gonna gargle with Listerine.
I haven't got bad breath.
I know.
But every time it snows, it seems you guys catch colds.
Yeah, but so do you and Dad.
And we can't stop them. But this year, we're going to all fight back with lots of sleep, good food, and Listerine twice a day.
That means I can't stay home from school.
Exactly. That's the whole idea. Now, last one into the bathroom is a big ape.
Bet big apes don't have to gargle.
No, only little apes.
This cold season, fight back with Listerine antiseptic.
Paul's mother, Annette Rosenbaum, was born Annette Lifschutz on September 16th, 1925.
My father's name was Abraham Lifschutz, but okay. He called himself Al. He was a fur manufacturer, manufactured fur coats. My mother's name was Lottie Slonim Lifschutz, but her real first name was Charlotte. As my father got older, he owned a barn grill. And he was the treasurer of the Queens Liquor Dealer Association. Ever since I've been a little girl, I became very ill. My parents were told I would never grow up. Then, when Alvin wanted to marry me, his father insisted I go to the family doctor and get a report. And the doctor said, "Yes, you can get married, but you'll never have children."
Needless to say, Annette defied all the odds. On June 18, 1930, 4.5-year-old Annette was dubbed as a future sensation when she was featured in Jack Garn's musical review of 1930 at the Strand Theater in Far Rockaway, New York.
Alvin lost his mother, Fanny, when he was 12 or 13. She was quite a beautiful woman. Alvin had a brother. His name was Paul Rosenbaum. He was an attorney. He was gorgeous, tall and handsome and beautiful. Married, he had one daughter. And one Sunday morning, early in the morning, the phone rings. His brother had had a heart attack and died. He was 30 years old. Very painful. So Paul was named for Paul.
Paul and his dad had the same sense of humor. Here's a 17-year-old Alvin accepting a dare from the Epsilon chapter of Sigma Beta Chi. He wrapped his legs and feet in burlap and sat in the middle of Jamaica Avenue at 168th Street with a pail of water and a dead fish. As the article says, he sat until an irate traffic cop put him to flight. Alvin was a dashing gentleman who had an early career in retail and sales. He worked for a men's clothing manufacturer. He was a traveling salesman who in some parts of the country was forced to use the name Alvin George instead of Alvin Rosenbaum. An excellent athlete, he was a fabulous ice skater and skier and would have gone pro if he hadn't suffered an injury. He played golf and was part of his lacrosse high school team. Alvin also belonged to a basketball team called Camp Winston. He discovered a love for tennis in his latter years and enjoyed taking his son fishing. It was one of those family traditions. Paul's Nana Lottie also loved the sport and taught Paul how to fish early on. Annette and Alvin met through mutual friends.
I had a friend, Sylvia, and her husband, Eddie. Eddie was Alvin's friend. She said, I want to introduce you to an extraordinary young man. He goes to the best restaurants, the best shows. You'll love him. So she arranges this date for Alvin and I to see each other. And after the fourth date, he said, we'll have to get married. He said, well, I made up my mind if I ever dated a girl six times, I'd marry her. I said, but we only dated three or four times.
Annette and Alvin were married in New York, February 23rd, 1946.
Religion was never a part of my family or my life, but Alvin was quite involved. And he said he wanted a rabbi to marry us.
The young couple had two sons, Paul and his brother Mark, who is 7 years his senior. Annette and Alvin traveled extensively. Among many other places, they went to London, Ireland, Spain, and Italy. They dressed impeccably and enjoyed socializing with their friends.
For years, we would take cruises, sometimes two or three cruises a winter. And sometimes we took the boys with us because he was exhausted. He was running, you know, from the different stores were in Connecticut, Long Island, so on. And he needed to rest. And we started going to Europe and Madeira. We went through France and Italy, and we went many places.
In March 1965, Alvin made a move that galvanized his family's ties to a wonderful community called Ocean Beach. He purchased his third store, the Flair House, in...
One day, a salesman comes into the store and says, I have another place for you to buy. And I had never heard of Fire Island. Alvin didn't know much about it. Honey Dobrow owned the store, she and her husband. The story Honey tells me is that as soon as I opened the door and let Alvin in, I knew he was going to buy it. Lots of people wanted to buy the store. She wouldn't sell it to them. But she turned to her husband and said, I'm selling it to him. And he bought it. Never saw it and bought it.
Paul seemed to approve. Here he is thanking his mother and father for selling nice stationery. He was always that sweet. Let's pause for another quick commercial break. When we come back, we'll delve a little bit more into Paul's young life and his budding career in show business.
And now my mom, the world's greatest chicken fixer, thanks to Wesson Oil. Hit it, Mom!
If you could see through yours like I can see through mine, well then you'd be frying chicken just as light as mine.
Light, because each drop of Wesson is filtered 24 times to make Wesson cook as light as it looks. Just wait till they taste your chicken.
It's the see-through cooking oil.
Wesson cooks as light as it looks.
Hey, I'll give you a flying nun for a Star Trek.
No.
Okay, Casper and Great Smoky Mountains.
There are 450 GAF Viewmaster packets in all.
Casper, Great Smoky Mountains, and...
So, if you own a GAF Viewmaster and your friend owns one, you could trade packets all day long.
I'll give you my Land of the Giants if you throw in peanuts, too.
No good.
If you can find any you want to trade.
Paul's acting career. In 1967, Paul wrote this essay where he states that he would like to become an actor. When he was about 7 or 8 years old, his father took him to meet with Mary Ellen White, a powerhouse talent agent who represented actors like Isabel Sanford, Marcia Strassman, and Dick Van Patten. As soon as she signed him up, young Paul's acting career began.
Paul at that time was about 8 years old, and I had a friend, and she would say, you know, I want you to take your son up to see my son's agent, Mary Ellen White, because he's perfect for commercials. And she sees Alvin, and she tells them, and they both got so excited. So they went together up to Mary Ellen White. She said, absolutely. She took them immediately, Paul, but she said, we have to change his name. He can't have the name Paul Rosenbaum. So between the two of them, they decided on P.R. Paul, and that became his name.
In 1969, his school wrote about Paul's most frequently aired commercial for the New York Yankees, advertising a bat boy contest. The article states that Paul appeared with Bobby Mercer, Roy White, Steve Hamilton, and others. Paul was also given a Bobby Mercer bat, a glove, an autographed Yankee baseball, a yearbook, and an official Yankee warm-up jacket.
But the best audition, one that I'll never forget, was the Yankee Bat Boy. My family, my husband, the boys, for generations have been Yankee fans, big Yankee fans. One day, Paul gets a call. They're going to do a commercial at Yankee Stadium. Yankee Bat Boy. Oh, he wanted that more than anything else. A few days later, I get a call from his agent, Paul got the commercial. He couldn't believe he had gotten it. He did it at Yankee Stadium. He played ball with the Yankees on the ball field. And then he said to me, and you know what? I used the same toilet they use. He said, this is the greatest day of my life.
Paul shot over 50 commercials as a child actor and went on to become a teen actor. He trained at both the New York and Berghoff schools of drama. Later, he was named one of the top 10 actors for Mary Ellen White's talent agency.
Mary Ellen White, who was my friend and an agent out here, had talked to me about this guy she had met in New York. She was Mary Ellen White, and the agency was M.E.W. It was never Mary Ellen White, it was M.E.W. And I thought for years Paul's real name was P.R. I don't think I ever really knew till, I don't know when, that I discovered that Paul's real name. It was Paul.
The Hollywood Nights. Paul co-starred in this film with Michelle Pfeiffer, Tony Danza, Fran Drescher, and Robert Wall, who to this day maintains a close friendship with Paul.
Hey, listen, we got all our cars here tonight, except one.
Yeah, Simpson, when are you going to bring your rail job? I mean, this is the last night.
Where is this a flying purple people eater you keep talking about?
Relax, relax. I got to wait till my old man goes to sleep so I can wheel it out.
Well, maybe you want me to follow you home. You know, you might be a little bit nervous.
Everybody is showing. You know, there is going to be a ton of lead sleds in the glock tonight.
That's great. You know what? Everyone's gonna think we're a bunch of 50 squares when they come in.
Hey, how long you got your brother's car for?
For as long as I like.
Yeah, sure.
In 1982, Paul won the role of Montgomery McNeil in the television series Fame.
If I were to describe Paul to someone, a mini red-headed Rodney Dangerfield comes to mind. I don't know. We were like the outcasts. We were like the persecuted ones. You know, here we are thrown on this set, you know, with all these people, and we were supposed to conform and act a certain way, and instead we just mocked everything. One thing I always admired about Paul is his ability to just be impervious to anything around him. You know, just he would plant himself in front of the camera and say his lines no matter what. Nothing would break his concentration.
Paul is the consummate professional. When we worked together, he was the anchor. He was the guy who just was not fazed by anything. Nothing could throw him.
Ready and action.
Or hiccups.
Yes. Would you hold back on that? Or RPG?
Cut it. And action.
Or hiccups. Would you hold back on
that? Cut it. And action.
Or hiccups.
Okay, that's all right. Keep rolling. Come on.
Stop.
Ready? And just try, Valerie. Action.
Well, the big pro finally does.
Common cold, would you withhold it from the public?
I do not have a cure for the common cold.
Or hiccups. Would you hold back with that? Or hickeys?
The close-knit cast of Fame got a chance to ham it up again for People magazine in 2001. In 1984, Paul was cast as Andy, a.k.a. Smooth Moves, in Snowballing.
You gotta get to the finish line and create a diversion. Dan, when you get up to the starting line, stall as long as possible. If the men's finals start on time, it's not going to give Karen and I the time that we need.
Oh, kid, what's going on?
I got a plan, a wild-ass idea on how to get back at Tulsa, and if I'm right, it's going to be beautiful.
He appeared as a guest star in The Dukes of Hazzard, Designing Women, and Chips. Paul switched to theater in 1988, playing the role of Chuck in Half-Deserted Streets, a play written by one of his closest friends, Bobby Maresco.
Victor's a very sweet guy who at the time was stark raving mad, and it was my first play, and I was sitting back trying to be the nice guy that I am, you know, and this guy was driving the director crazy. And every day at rehearsal, Paul would say to me, just leave it alone, it's fine, it's gonna work out fine, leave it to the director. And then the night of the first preview, this guy just went so bad. I stood up and I threw my script at him. I chased him on stage. He ran out of the theater. I chased him up 28th Street. And I'm all out of breath. And I can't catch him because he's faster than me. And I look at PR stand, Paul standing next to me with the director. And he looked at me and the director said, are you ready to go on? And I said, oh, Jesus, my first play. And then for an hour, me and Paul are running lines. I'm going to go on stage. And thank God the guy showed up. And I didn't have to go on stage. Thank God.
The two collaborated again in the series Falcone, where Paul played a federal agent named Pesci.
We all went down to the bar every night after shooting, and this piano player would play Don't Cry for Me, Argentina every night.
Came in this morning. My hunch was right on the money.
I have very fond memories of Paul coming by my apartment to do his laundry. You know, Patty LaPone had stopped by. We were going to go out and have lunch, and Paul showed up. And she said, hi, Paul. And he said, oh, hi, Patty. What are you doing here? And she said, well, what are you doing here? And he said, I'm doing my laundry. And she said, oh. And I said, hi, Paul. And she was kind of like looking at the two of us. And he said, hi, honey, to me. And she started to spread really, really vicious rumors about us.
And with that, we'll have to take a break. When we come back, Paul agonizes over a family dilemma that forces him to make a life-changing decision.
Oh, honey, let's stop for him.
Yeah.
Oh, come on, you were young once.
Hi.
Hi. I just need a lift to the first Gulf station.
First what?
The first gasoline station.
No, I only run out of Gulf gasoline.
You only run out of...
You may have to ride a lot further.
Oh, that's okay. I'll just wait for Gulf.
You're gonna buy a whole gallon, huh?
George.
Well, when it comes to gasoline, Gulf is really good because
it's a big cowboy. Not good enough for you?
Oh, it isn't Gulf.
24-hour service.
It isn't Gulf service. Oh, here's a Gulf station.
Thanks.
There are good reasons to wait for a Gulf station. Good people, good service, and good products.
Boss, can I help you?
Fill her up.
Any Gulf gasoline or motor oil we sell has been tested in the laboratory to meet our high standards of quality.
Come again. Bring your car.
Next time, wait for a Gulf station to come along. It's worth waiting for.
Going out with skinny Marcia again?
Yeah, runt.
Does Dad know you're using his English leather aftershave?
Yeah, and his English leather shave cream, shampoo, and stick deodorant. Man's gotta develop good grooming habits.
Smooth. You smell good, too. Too good for skinny Marcia. Hey, I hear old Marcia's men wear English leather or...
Don't say it.
English leather for men.
Paul's busy acting schedule never deterred him from spending time with his family. He went on family trips for the holidays. Annette and Alvin continued to do their own traveling throughout Europe until 1988. Late that summer, Paul's beloved dad started to feel ill. He was in constant pain. He was taken to the hospital on the mainland from Fire Island, where he was diagnosed with advanced prostate cancer. He lived only a few short months after his diagnosis. On February 24th, 1989, the man that Paul adored was gone. Paul now faced a major dilemma. Should he let go of the store his father worked so hard to build, to continue acting? Should he take over the business to further his father's legacy? Al Quattrocci Sr., who was like a father to Paul in Los Angeles, talks about Paul during that time.
He was really torn between the loss of his dad and going back to New York and everything falling on his shoulders now. I remember I spoke to him before he went back. He made a decision that he was going to go back and he was going to run the store. I said, Paul, I said, all the things that your dad taught you, and he really looked up to his dad. He really loved his dad. I said, all the things that your dad taught you, I said, those are the things you're going to put in place now when you run the store. And when, you know, do the best that you can so your dad's really going to be present. Do it as if he's watching you while you're running the store. So he'll really be proud of you for what you do, Paul. I know you can do it.
In the summer of 1989, Paul semi-retired from acting and took over the Flair House. Of course, nothing was going to be easy. A major storm hit Fire Island that year. Paul had no choice. He dealt with it with his usual sense of humor and weathered through the best he could. Throughout it all, he had the help of a woman who knew Flair House inside out. Jill Feehan.
Jill got her first job at Playhouse through Paul. They discussed it, he went to his father and she was hired. And she was in high school.
I've been at Flair House since 1978. You know, it's very rare to really be able to work with somebody and not have to speak and know what they want you to do, know what you should do, and what needs to be done. And the reason I'm lucky enough to have that with Paulie is because I worked with his father from 1978 until his father died. And Paul obviously worked with his father his whole life. So we had the best training in retail that you could have. I was really fortunate to learn from the best. Paul learned from the best, and I'm fortunate enough to still work with Paul.
Now, because Jill has known Paul all her life and has worked with him for 28 years, she's got his routine down pat. Here's Jill impersonating what Paul does when he first checks in the store. He walks in, picks up the spindle of sales, takes a quick look-see around the store. He plops down in the rattan chair by the sweatshirt area, hikes up one, not two, just one leg up on the chair, pulls his head back to check the sales figures for the last few hours or so. Checks it some, really scrutinizes it, studies it like he's getting ready for an exam in school or something, looks at the sales figures with a fine-tooth comb to see how the day is going, and finally, when he is satisfied, gets up, walks back to the counter, plops the spindle down and greets everyone.
Hey guys!
That is on an okay day at the Flair House. Paul worked his tail off that first summer and every summer thereafter trying to achieve what his father had.
And when he came back after the season was over, he came over to see me. He says, Al, I had the best year we ever had. And he was so happy about it, you know? And he put his whole soul into it. He really worked hard at it. And it was a big turning point for him.
My father would probably totally be in shock at the wonderful job that Paul has been doing at Flair House since his death in 1989. I'm sure he's flabbergasted at how well Paul has taken the store from 1989 to 2005. And I'm sure he never expected that Paul could have ever accomplished this.
I think he's done a fantastic job. Everybody talks about him. Everybody talks about the store and the clothing, and I think he's done an incredible job.
Paul started to build his own Flair House family. Although Jill Feehan continues to work at the Flair House to this day, she stepped down as full-time manager to take a full-time job in her children's school in 1997. Paul hired Martha Roll, who worked for a few summers until she, too, had to get a full-time job. Kim Puckett walked into the Flair House looking for a job and found herself one. One that she's been at for 8 years. Knowing Paul for 8 years, Kim, too, has her version of Paul at the Flair House on a bad day. Paul knows that it's a slow day. He walks in the store, grabs the spindle, takes a quick look, gets disgusted, and throws the spindle back on the counter.
So what are you guys doing around here?
Through the good days and the bad days, Paul hung in there like the trooper he is. He concentrated on being a good boss to his Flair House family, like his father.
He's like a father to me. You know, I get him a Father's Day card every summer. Some woman had approached me on the street and asked me if Paul was my father. And I said, yeah, and then she kind of looks at me and she goes, so is that your mother? Talking about Joy. And I said, yeah, she is. And she just walks away thinking, okay, I don't know how that happened, but okay.
Of course, he's such a wonderful boss. He even says hello and smiles at me when I'm on my way stumbling through town.
I guess I see him as like a father type figure because he's always, you know, watching over me and like sees me coming home at night and is always, you know, where were you? Do you need a ride home? Do you have a flashlight? He's, you know, he's always there for me. I come in, he asks how my day's going before I do anything else. You know, he wants to know how I am. And he's a great boss, because there are those bosses who you just fear and you just don't want them around. And then there's Paul, who comes in and, you know, he's like dancing to Putumayo. And like, you know, he's like, oh, you want some candy? You know, he's just very giving and just, he's fun to be around.
I've been coming to Fire Island since 1968. I always shopped at the Flair House. And my daughter went to sleepaway camp one fine day, and Jill said to me, when I was lamenting, I had nothing to do, she said, why don't you work here? And the rest is history. He's really become such a good friend. He's the salt of the earth. He's wonderful.
Ever since I was little, I wanted to work there too, because I always just wanted to like be like her. And so when I would be, you know, like really little, I would try to go behind the counter and like I would feel, you know, all special because like my mom worked there. And then when I was 13, I started to work there. Paul was still really nice to me because he like really trusts us. We were sitting like on the bench or something in front and someone was on the ground. And like my one friend like dropped a cigarette or something and he was like, can I talk to you for a second? And I was like, sure. And I didn't really know what he was gonna say because I didn't know he saw. And he was like, he's like, if I ever catch you with a cigarette, I'll kill you. And I was like, yeah, I know. It's okay, like, don't worry.
We're always talking, and he always says something to me like, ooh, I'm gonna slap you so hard when you wake up. That shirt's gonna be out of style. Something like that. And then he always gives me a hard time about everything, but that's one of the reasons that I like him. I was thinking about getting the job at Town Pizza as being a delivery boy, and then he talked to Angelo, and he said that if I ever do anything wrong, he'd slap me upside the head. That's what he said. And then, so every day, whenever I make deliveries, and I go in his Flair House to tell my mom or something, he always says, like, hey, how much did you make? I get 5-10%.
Yeah.
And I'm, yeah, huh? I always say, sure, but I'm never gonna give him the money.
In addition to Paul's Flair House family is, of course, his Fire Island family. Sit back, because coming up is what they all have to say about him in 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Dynamint.
6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Dynamint.
In just 6 seconds, Dynamints with cooling menthol starts making your breath feel kissing fresh.
6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Dynamint!
Dynamints with cooling menthol starts freshening breath in 6 seconds.
I got it!
The great combination, root beer and ice. Barrelhead got them together because Barrelhead's real draft-style root beer with old-fashioned flavor that stands up to ice and a long-lasting head that'll tickle your mustache. So enjoy a delicious mug of the root beer with old-fashioned draft-style flavor, Barrelhead, and don't spare the ice.
That's right. Don't spare the ice, because if there's anything in Paul's life that warrants a toast, it most certainly is his family of friends.
I know one thing about him. He's
one of the people that loves me as a friend, and I love him. I love this guy. You know, he's just a good human being. I seen his. He's a caring human being for other people. I seen him doing things for other people, which very personal. He shows his humanity. That you are poorly, and he's the greatest. We love him.
He's a wonderful sense of humor, and I think he's very good-natured. I think you could count on him if you really needed a friend. And Paul has just always been there. He's been part of the family.
Quick with his tongue. I guess comes from his background in the arts on the stage. He's always got a line to say, always has something, you know, funny, you know, apropos to the situation. Funny guy like that. He's always lively. He's always the, you know, I mean, when he's in the room, you know he's there, that's for sure.
I've known Paul for 35, maybe 40 years, I think. Paul is very, very funny. Sarcastic, a whiner, kind, very lucky to have Joy, and a good friend.
Paul is a creep, okay? And I've known Paul, the hideous little creep, for about 35, 37 years. Paul has five interests, counting the ones, the fives, the 10s, the 20s, and the 50s.
Paul's a good guy. Paul's definitely a good guy. We had some fun times together. Paul is just so sweet. He's so sweet, and you always just have a nice conversation with Paul. And, you know, now knowing Paul, like, you know, with us being shop girls and, you know, him having so much experience, he's always been just, you know, really supportive of Maria and I. So it's just always been good. You know, he does like to complain a lot, you know, customers, sales, this, that. He definitely has his shtick. Paul definitely has his shtick, and I love it.
Paul is like a little, a little dog with a lot of energy.
One of the kindest, genuinest, if that's a word, people in the world who would do anything for really anybody, but especially his friends. Paul loves to really surround himself with people, whether he's in the store, whether he's sitting on the bench, whether he's playing music, whether he's listening to music, whether he's playing ball, whether he's shopping in the market, anything I think he likes to be with people.
I opened this little store in 1994, and within a short time, Paul walked across the street probably to see what I was doing, make sure I wasn't selling any of his merchandise. He was always friendly and helpful, and somebody to call if I needed something, and a friendship group. We went from shopkeepers to friends.
He was my son's counselor. He never forgave me because I never gave him a tip at the end of the season. I didn't know about tips. And we flew back to California and that was the end of it. And he probably thought we were terrible. Since then, he's been a good friend, a true friend. And now he has the joy in his life. It's like we're even closer. Well, he's very generous. And we've had some great laughs together. He's very funny.
Paul has been a fixture of Fire Island for many years, and I remember his father going way back to Flair House. Well, Paul is a very gracious guy, and he's a very wonderful guy, a nice guy, and he's really well loved by everybody out here.
He seems to be very interested in politics. He's a left winger, like a lot of us, and the interesting thing is when some of our, and there were luckily very few right wing friends, give their opinions. Paul is probably the most animated. He gets more angry than others. Is like most of us. He seems to be most at home when he's sitting on a bench with his friends.
He loves the bench. I don't think he can live without the bench. He can live without the other things, but the bench. He's a real bench person.
I love Paul because it gives me a discount in the store all the time. He's got the heartbeat on Fire Island, that's for sure. Seems like a real cheerful guy. Always got a smile on his face.
I think Paul is a fiery little guy with an opinion about just about everything. And he's the keeper of Chico's wares, which is very important in this town, because Chico is the glue that holds the bench together. Paul is the man behind the glue.
I love him. Paul's like, if I had teddy bears, Paul would be, you know, one of my teddy bears. He's sweet, kind, funny, and just doesn't act his age. Paul is basically just a juvenile delinquent, okay?
This juvenile delinquent is known for a lot of things, but across the board, everybody knows that the one thing Paul loves more than anything else in the world is baseball.
He loves his baseball.
Paul loves baseball.
He was in the Little League. I remember he was so small when he was part of the team, nobody believed he was on the team. And he would get up and swing the bat and hit a ball. Nobody believed it.
He does love to play baseball. Every Tuesday he plays ball. It's Paul's little release, you know, from the whole week. He can go play ball and just let loose and do what he wants to do and have fun.
You know, the better part of the summer I've watched you play softball. I got to tell you something. You really, I watch you play second base. Definitely one of the better second basemen I've seen out here. You're really an excellent ball player. You've got your athletic. You've got baseball skills. For a guy that's not a big guy, you seem to generate an awful lot of power. You're really a total package.
You hit a play? Okay, where's your boy? Where's this Fast Eddie? That's Fast Eddie? That little runt in the striped shirt? He don't look so fast. Ha! Lucky shot. Hey, he shoots hard. Look at him blast them marbles. He's pretty fast. Where'd he pick up a game like that?
Fast Eddie? It's the new marble game from Mattel.
Hey, sport. Know what you might have thrown away with that Sport Cola cap? A baseball, or a mitt, or a bat. Or golf balls, or golf clubs for your dad. Or roller skates. Or how about a bike? Or a tennis racket? Or maybe a real McCoy go-kart? Yep, you might have won any of those great prizes from sensational tasting Sport Cola. By the way, does your mom know Sport Cola is 99% caffeine-free? Now, about the contest, just pull back the label inside the sport cap and see what you won. Free caps available at your store. Who knows?
Yippee!
Maybe you'll get real lucky and win them all. Get full details where you buy Sport Cola.
Now let's take a look at how Paul's West Coast family began. In 1978, Paul moved from New York to Los Angeles for his acting career. On the first day he arrived, his friend John Kerner, also a New Yorker, took him to play ball. On that fateful day on the basketball court, unbeknownst to Paul, he had met what would turn out to be his Los Angeles family.
We hung out down at John Jay Park, we played basketball together, went to Robert Wagner Junior High to play ball together. We were friends. We hung out with two different groups, but we were friends. We played sports together. I always thought Paul's a pretty cool guy. Then I got to know him. Anyway, I moved to California with two buddies of mine, and then shortly thereafter, Paul moved out. A couple months later, we had met the Quattrochis and the Morescos already.
We had played basketball with John Kerner and Ray and some of the guys from New York, and we all kind of bonded because we were all from New York. So the next week, we went down, played at Westchester Park. And PR showed up, and you know, we all played hoops. And then Bobby, as the normal, you know, Mr. Maresco would do, would invite a million people back to the house, you know, and we'd have a barbecue. And Paul came over, and I think we couldn't get rid of him after that. It was basically he was bonded to the Maresco Q family, and he, you know, we've been great friends ever since. Paul is like the leprechaun in Lucky Charms. He's a very funny guy, and he's got a really big heart. he's a good guy. He's a good spirit. Paul's as smart as they come. I mean, he's streetwise, and he's been able to think on his feet. You know, he's one of these guys that can problem solve. He's really, really quick. He can think, he can surmise things and do things really fast. And I always admired that. Me and Paul have a love-hate relationship. I mean, we really are like brothers, but it's almost like a marriage. You're friends for so long, you're gonna fight, you're gonna, you know, make up, you're gonna be friends. So through it all, we kind of know each other better than anybody. You know, we're just really like blood brothers. So he's really part of the family. I mean, he's the prodigal son. My father idolizes Paul. I mean, they love baseball, and I would consider him, you know, one of my churches, you know.
I remember when Al came home with him from the park, and he and John Kerner came to the house, and he never left. He's still there. And I just feel like he's been part of the family for almost 30 years. He spends holidays with us, and like my husband said before, he's been such a friend. He's always been there when we needed him. There's nothing that I could ask him that he would refuse. He's just the best, and he's kept us laughing for 30 years, and I guess there were some times when we cried together, but he's always been there, and Paul will always have a special place in my heart, and I almost feel like he's a son.
If you're looking for a friend, a good friend, Paul is the guy. I'll never forget when I was in the hospital. Every morning he was there at 9 o'clock in the morning. He would come and he would just be there with me and everything. And things like that you just can't forget. I mean, he was there every single morning. And, you know, that's a friend. That's a friend.
Paul first got fame. My father was a longshoreman. And, you know, he's a very simple guy, great guy. I called him up, I said, my dad just bought my daughter a swing set. And so I called him up, I said, come on, we gotta build a swing set. And Paul comes over and he spends like 9 hours, you know. We put in a swing set, and Paul had to do a swing set, because I would watch him. Like, he used to watch me play basketball, I'd watch him build swing sets. And when he's done, my father gives him a $5 tip. He's like making $3,000 a week in like 1977. I said, Dad, you don't have to tip him, he makes more money than us. Life is good, life continues. You did my daughter's swing set, and you just did my grandson's swing set. So if I have any more children, I'm glad you're around. Great guy, good heart, one of the most honest people I've ever met.
The first time I met Paul, Bobby called me and said, Barb, I'm bringing home someone for dinner. Little did I know it was the whole basketball team, but Paul was one of them, and he came from New York, so right away we had a rapport with him, and he stayed for dinner, and then he came back every night after that for dinner for the next 28 years. Paul is a special friend of ours. We know his mom and we knew his dad, and he's very close and special to Bobby and me. He has the best sense of humor. He can make me laugh, and he knows everything about us, so there's a special feeling there between all of us, and there's nothing he doesn't know about me and my family, my children, my husband, everyone.
I first met Paul in New York at Heart or High, where we were filming the pilot for Fame. This is where I met Lee, and this is where I met Paul, and because Paul's and my characters were best friends in this pilot, so we were immediately thrown together and spent a lot of time talking, and Paul had this band called Raw Meat, and we used to go to the Blue Lagoon to see Paul sing in this band, and I used to hang out with Paul. This was before I met James, my husband, and you know, Paul is the guy who like pulled me out of parties. Paul's the guy who like made sure I got home. He was really like the good, you know, like the good protective brother, and then later he would really become my other husband. He's my husband who taught me how to ski. If I had to describe Paul to somebody who didn't know, I mean, I would say short. No, I would say cute, sexy, kind, unbelievably generous and considerate, funny, smart. I listen to Paul, like when Paul gives me notes on songs, scripts, anything. Paul is one of the people I'll always listen to. Paul is a great voice of reason for me. He may not have voice of reason for himself, but he always has amazing voice of reason for other people, and he is that for me.
When I first met Paul, I was addicted to restaurants, nice restaurants. And Paul wasn't very really into food. He was sort of a gastronomic deprivation addict or something. And so slowly he became as interested in nice restaurants as I was. So we had we used to go out to dinner all the time. We have a musical relationship where I've produced quite a number of songs for Paul and been a sideman for him on gigs that he's done. I made a lot of music with Paul. He wrote a lot of really great songs.
Living on the West Coast, Paul was able to spend more time with his older brother Mark and two nephews, Alex and Doran, who live in Northern California. Everyone also knows that music is one of Paul's major passions. In 1982, Paul formed a band called Raw Meat with his friend Ralph Stevens.
In the beginning, there was the meat, Raw Meat. Paul and I were at a party. We used to play softball. And after playing softball every Sunday, we would go out to Gary's house because there was a pool, and we'd jump in the pool, and everybody would party out there. Gary and Bob Wall and Paul and I used to be at the piano, and I'd play piano or someone else would play piano, and we'd just sing a bunch of songs. There was a guy named Carl Bellotti, and he was kind of like an animal guy. He was, you know, like a street guy. And he was all the time, you know. So I think we used to say we need to give him some raw meat. And I think that's where the idea of raw meat came from. Paul was our front guy. Paul and I wrote all the songs. He played the guitar also. We played a lot of shows in town. The Troubadour was one of the places that we really liked. But we had a great time. We really had a great time.
In 2003, Paul and his friend Al cooked up a business idea by accident. They had been churning this delicious gourmet toffee for friends for 18 years. They missed 1 year due to strained schedules, and the world went into an uproar. Someone suggested they should turn their hobby into a business, and the rest, as they say, is history.
When we were really like little children, we met in the sugarcane fields in South Africa, and Paul was hanging with this tribe, and I was with another tribe. And it was one of those things where we just kind of were picking sugar cane together. And we realized, you know, candy was going to eventually be in our future. Really, the way it all started was 1 year we just said, you know what, we sent it to everybody, and then we just put a little flyer in there saying, hey, anybody want to buy some Butter Bing, you know, or for a family, a friend, as an extra one, you know? And we got like over 300 orders in like 2 weeks, and it got insane. And that's when I realized, me and Paul looked at each other and like all the angels went off in the kitchen, and it was like, this is it. Okay, this is the start of something, because people really love this stuff.
Let's take our final break. Now make sure you stick around, because when we get back, you'll hear the juicy details of what everyone has to say about Paul getting married. This is when things get brutal.
We asked Timothy Collins of Des Moines, Iowa to try new Buitoni instant pizza. Will he appreciate that only Buitoni has a double crust which surrounds all the delicious juicy filling? What do you think, Timmy?
Signore, questa pizza, un pezzo d'arte, gustosa, deliciosa, una meraviglia.
One bite of Buitoni instant pizza is a real Italian mouthful. Cheese, sausage, or pepperoni. Just toast and serve. Timothy Collins, mille grazie.
Prego.
A kid named Jack found out about Polaroid's new zip that's out. It shoots color in black and white. Now he's shooting everything in sight.
He's Jack the Zipper. Jack the Zipper.
He'll sneak up and say, excuse me, miss, and in 60 seconds your picture's his.
Jack the Zipper. Jack the Zipper.
He never worries about the light. His zip just knows when the light is right.
Jack the Zipper. Jack the Zipper.
With a Polaroid zip, he's never through. So watch your step, he'll zip you too.
Jack the Zipper. Jack the Zipper.
Well, it's dynamite, all right, because we've saved the best for last. In the spring of 2004, Paul makes the biggest decision he's ever made in his life. He proposed to Joy Tan, and they were married on April 5th, 2004, on the beautiful island of Lanai, Hawaii.
He's much better with Joy. He's a lot more looser. Before he got married to Joy, he was kind of uptight a lot. You know, he'd have five or six girlfriends at once, but he was still a little uptight, you know. But Joy's good for him. In fact, after he got married and we all met Joy, we kind of figured, you know, we'd keep her, you know, get rid of him.
You weren't married then. And I said, Paul, I'm not telling, because he didn't like anybody to tell him what to do. And as I'm ready to leave that day, I said, I'm not telling you what to do, but think about it. And then lo and behold, a few months later, I get the call. I didn't believe it. That was the call of my life.
I don't know, it's probably a little selfish. There was a part of me that sort of hoped that Paul would actually stay single so I can continue to have him as my other husband. But I'm really, really happy that he found Joy. And I'm really happy that he's a married guy now. It's like I got to be like a full grown up. I think if Paul hadn't gotten married, he would have ended up living with us, which would have been absolutely fine with me.
You and Joy, I was so glad when the both of you got married, and just wish you the best, Paul, because you are the best.
We're very happy for him and Joy, and they both compliment each other.
I don't know what the town thought, but I thought he was the luckiest sucker ever. He was going out with his little boy, and he was struggling with her. And he went from the sand fields to the gold mines. That's what I thought, and I still think that.
But he called me, he said, I think I met the person that if we're still together next Christmas, I'm gonna ask her to marry me. So of course, knowing Paul as I have, I said, my first question is how old is she? Then when I met her, perfect. We love Joy, and he loves Joy, and we love having her in our family.
I've gone through with him with the times where he was looking for the girl, the right girl. Then, all of a sudden, he tells me he's going to get married with this girl. And I says, wow, that's great, Paul. You've been looking for 15 years. I mean, finally, it's happening. You sure? He says, yeah, I think I'm going to marry this one. So he goes back to California. He says, Joey, I don't know. Things have changed because, he says, I don't know. I didn't know something about her. He says, what? I says, oh no, he's gonna go on the search again. She has a temper, Joey. I don't know what I'm gonna do. She has a temper. And then, before you know it, it was forgotten, never mentioned again. He brings her over to the island, introduces us to us, and she's incredible. She's like, in a half a minute, she became one of us, and we all love her, and it was the best thing for him.
Took quite a while. I mean, he must have put up quite a fight to stay single for all these years, and he finally caught himself a gem.
I thought he'd never get married. I mean, Elliot and Carl, Mike Bobson and Joey and Mr. Levitt, they were all highly disappointed.
You have a gorgeous wife. I like your wife better than I like you. That's why I like coming by your house all the time.
I talked till I was blue in the face, and he decided to do it anyway. And the long and the short of it is that he was very fortunate because he found this wonderful girl. He's a lucky guy, a very lucky guy.
All right, let me tell you something. The first thing I said to him when I heard, before I heard he was getting married, when he left that summer, when I left here, when we both went out separate ways that summer, after I first met the girl he was going to marry, I said to myself, or I said to my wife also, I said, if that schmuck comes back next year not married to her, he would have his head examined. Really, he deserves what he gets if he doesn't do that.
How did he get such a fabulous life? What has this guy got? Who is this guy?
Warning, the following conversations may not be suitable for children under 12, people who are politically correct, or anyone with taste.
After that incident with the little boy, he seemed to have gone downhill for a while. When he met Joy, which is a surprise to all of us because we thought he was gay, we hoped the thing with the kid
the children are behind him.
I was pretty shocked that he was getting married because I always thought he was gay.
I think he's a half a fig.
There are so many single guys out here. I mean, and the half of Cherry Grove and the Pines were highly disappointed when he got married.
I love you, babe. Show me your breasts.
However brutal the humor gets throughout all of this, what is evident is one thing. Paul is very much like his father, Alvin. He is well-loved by many, many people. Wherever he goes, whatever he does, Paul has the knack for building lifelong relationships with people who end up loving him for life.
This is a song that has no meaning. It has no melody or rhyme. It's just a song to say I'm grateful to have lived this long time. It's just a song, it's nothing special. It's just I had these extra chords and a few words left over from a song I wrote before. Second chances too. I kept my guardian angel running, and her race is not yet through. You see, I took the road less traveled, but I got lost along. And it's really quite a miracle that I'm still here today.
. 2005, Paul and Joy purchased the Flair House building. The building is in serious disrepair and hasn't been touched in at least 40 years. The couple took the big leap and renovated, completely gutted the three apartments above the Flair House, and extended the back of the store for much-needed storage space. It was important to the couple that the store's appearance reflected the pride they felt in being part of the Ocean Beach community. The job was completed in the summer of 2006. In an article Paul wrote in 1996 for the Ocean Beach Diamond Jubilee Directory, he recounts his very first experience in Fire Island. He was an 8-year-old boy who took his first ferry to Ocean Beach in March 1965. He says, "It seemed like we were the first people allowed back after a nuclear war. Not a creature was stirring." He also mentions in the article that one of his father's employees, Jane Lawrence, came into the store one day after Paul took over and said that if she had her eyes closed, she could have sworn that Paul was his father. He sounded just like him. That was music to his ears. Paul said, and I quote, "It meant I was carrying on the tradition established by my father as I stole some of his best and worst lines. As he had friends who would come in to aggravate him, I now have mine. He died years ago, but his spirit continues to dominate the Flair House. Anytime I have a question, I ask myself, what would Big Al have done? As I walk to work, I see him looking down at me saying, 'So, you thought it was going to be easy?' Well, it's 2006, and Paul and his family now celebrate Flair House's 41st anniversary. The building looks amazing, and it's a wonderful addition to the community. Paul has not only succeeded in his quest to carry on the tradition his father Alvin had established, he has surpassed it. His mother, as well as all of us, are very proud. And surely Alvin, up there, wherever he is the proudest of all.
Happy birthday, Uncle Paul.
I love you. You're a wonderful person. You're a good son.
A happy 50th birthday.
Happy birthday.
And I want to wish you a really happy birthday. You're a great friend.
Paul, happy birthday.
Happy birthday, Paul.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday, Paul, from the Charltons.
Happy birthday, Paul.
Oh, happy birthday, Paul.
What is it?
How old is it?
Happy birthday.
4-0.
Happy birthday. We wish you all the best.
By the way,
he's 50, not 40. You look good for 40. You look terrible for 50.
No, you look good. Keep up the good work. Stay healthy.
Happy birthday, Paul. Happy birthday, Paul. Congratulations, honey. Oh, my God. I thought it was 40.
Well, happy birthday, Paul.
Happy birthday, Paul.
Hey, Paul. Happy 50th.
Five! Oh! You look too old. Happy birthday.
Happy birthday, Paul.
We love you. You're always good for a laugh and a really nice guy, so you're always welcome here. You know, if Joy kicks you out, you can sleep on the couch over here. All right? Have a great birthday, and see you soon.
I thought I was...
It's okay.
Oh, no,
come on. Happy birthday.
Paul, happy birthday. I hope great, you know, birthday. You have a great, and I wish you many more.
It's good.
The film is
going.
All big five. Happy birthday, Paul. You'll always be 20 to me, and you always look 20.
Happy birthday, love, and many, many, 150 more.
Happy birthday to my favorite Hollywood night.
Hey, Polly. We wish you a happy 50th, and it's just... great to know. It's just the last, what, 20 years that we've known each other? I've known Paul, more or less. So anyway, happy 50th, and we wish you the best, and hope to see you soon.
Yeah, and Paul, her head isn't that big, all right? Thank you.
Hey, Paul, happy birthday.
Turning 60? You don't look 60, you look like 50.
Happy birthday, Paulie.
Happy birthday, Paul!
Happy birthday. P.R. Paul, happy birthday to you. Happy 50th and 50 more.
Happy birthday to you. Cha cha cha. Happy birthday to you. Cha cha cha. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. You live in a new. You smell like you. And you look like one tail.
Happy birthday to you, Paul, I gotta tell you, it was a pleasure meeting you and your girlfriend, because when you're not here, I have somebody to go eat with. Happy birthday, Paul.
I wish you the best, man. Another 50.
Happy birthday, Paul, and remember, ask for Pesci and get half off.
Love you. Happy birthday.
Happy birthday, Paul, and many, many, many more.
Paul, we love you, and we're wishing you a happy 50th and many, many more.
Happy birthday, half a buck. Many, many more.
Love you a lot, Paul. Happy birthday.
What is it, 60th?
Hi, Paul. It's me and Coco. I wanted to let you know, we thought about abstaining, but we wanted to wish you a happy birthday because you're such a great friend.
So, 50? 50, that's really f***ing old, dude.
PR, much love, and have a happy, happy, happy birthday.
Happy birthday, Paul. 50 years old. You're still very good looking, handsome, sweet, sweet gentleman. Happy birthday.
Happy birthday, PR. Happy 50th. You don't get day over 35.
I just want to say you're just like a brother to me, so happy birthday, and have a couple extra drinks for me.
So to one of the shortest,
kindest, sweetest, and most honest people I've ever known, and I mean that with all my heart. Happy birthday, Paul. Many, many happy more, and we all love you at the Maresco House.
Happy birthday, Paul. I can't begin to be 50, and I can't believe we've been friends all these years, and I thank you for that friendship. You know more than anyone how much that means to us, and I'm hoping that we'll be able to share this special day with you. Happy birthday.
Happy birthday, Paul, and many, many, many more birthdays to come, and we'll be happy to celebrate your 50th when you get back to L.A. I will make you your favorite dinner.
I don't know how I can say this other than say you've been a good friend, you've been a great guy, and I wish you a happy 50th birthday.
Keep laughing, keep smiling, keep making people, you know, crack up and be yourself, and it's all good, man. You know, it's all good. Happy birthday. We love you.
Happy birthday, Paul. I love you. And welcome to the Over 50 Club. If you haven't already, you'll soon be getting a notice from the AARP. And they'll want you to join. And I hope you do.
When Valerie called me and asked me to be on video, greeting Paul and wishing him a happy birthday, I was really, really excited. I told her to get the f*** off my phone.
Oh, this is, you know, I'm going to say this, I'm going to start to cry. I love you, Paul. I love you forever. I am so happy to have both of us made it this far and still be friends. I love you, baby. Happy birthday.
She's got major leaps. She runs after flies. Hey, she catches ground balls. She's such a hit at the plate. Next to the babe, she stands tall. With diamonds in her ears and a turned up nose. When she was a kid, she wore tomboy's clothes. She's grown up a lady and heaven knows. When she puts on a dress, go whoa, whoa, whoa. Cause she's a little left fielder with a bat and a cap. Got major league stats. She runs after flies. She catches ground balls. She's such a hit at the plate. Next to the base, she stands tall. Hits keep coming as the season drags on. When it's over, she'll be gone, gone, gone. She listens to the coach. Yeah, she does what I say. Only wish I could marry her, take her away. Cause she's a little left fielder with a bat. She's got major league stats. She runs after flies, yeah. She catches ground balls. Such a hit at the plate next to the base.